Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Xiang Gao. Welcome to this online event presented by the University of Delaware Master Players Concert Series. I am the director of the series. Welcome. So now I'm really pleased to introduce my guest, our final guest of this season, Professor Martin Katz, to your screens. Many of you already know that his scheduled appearance on Master Players stage back in May was canceled due to the COVID-19 crisis. And we're hoping to bring him back very soon. He has also appeared many times on Master Players in the past, including conducting our concert opera, The Magic Flute by Mozart, a few years ago. That was so great, a wonderful moment that I would always remember. Martin was my chamber music teacher, actually, when I was a student at the University of Michigan. And he remained a really close friend and was really one of the most inspiring musicians I've ever met in my career. And he has been cited as the gold standard of piano accompanists by the New York Times. He has had a 50-year career taking him to 5 different continents, collaborating with the world's most celebrated singers in recitals and also in recordings. So Martin, I hope you could hear me. Welcome to Master Players Backstage Pass Online.
I can hear you perfectly. All of you out there, thank you for joining this webinar. It's my very first webinar of my life, so I hope it's okay.
Martin, would you remind me and share with the audience, what are we discussing today with you?
Gosh, what are we discussing? Violin playing, no? No. We're discussing what a collaborative pianist is, what's involved in being such an animal, and how it's different from other animals in the zoo, in the musical zoo.
Yes, that's great. I'm so happy with the troubled world today that we're able to share some beautiful stuff and some positive messages, and especially music is so universal. So why did you pick the piano? What happened?
It was such a non-dramatic thing. My aunt and uncle had a piano. I was 5 years old. They had 2 daughters who both were taking piano lessons, and I was very envious of them. And I just said to my folks, I want to play the piano. So they bought me a $100 upright piano, and I started.
Would you share with us, because collaborative pianists is a big field right now in our industry. I have always promoted the importance of collaborative piano playing, really because of people like you. What are the most important prerequisites for a collaborative pianist to have?
Well, it'd be easier to list the things that are not necessary for a collaborative pianist. You have to have a love of making music with other people, whether they be string players like you, Xiang, or whether they be singers. In my case, because I worked, 90% with singers, you have to have a love of telling stories, because all our music has words to it. And I always say the words are the boss, so they tell us about our musical decisions. What else? You have to understand a little bit the mechanics of the instrument or the voice that you're playing for. Not as if you were doing it yourself, but enough to know about breathing and changing the bow and all kinds of things like that. And I think you have to be pretty good with people. Don't you think? I mean, you could have all the collaborative talent in the world, but if you didn't have people skills, who would hire you, you know?
That's true. The first poll question on your screens, multiple choices. What is the primary role of a vocal coach? Oh my God, I love these answers. Funny. And they actually did come from Martin. So I'm sure he'll be very pleased to see the result. So Martin, when did you decide you want to become a collaborative pianist? Like today, moving on, I want to play with other people.
I was about 13 or 14 years old, and a kid across the street from me played the trumpet. And I had already taken piano lessons, as I told your audience before, for about 7-8 years. And he was working on the Haydn trumpet concerto. And I heard him practicing it, and I went over and said hello and whatever. We knew each other. And he asked me if I would play it with him, and I said, sure. And that was my first experience that I remember playing with another person. I thought it was just great. Socially was great, musically was great. for the color was great, because, you know, I can't sound exactly like a trumpet, for heaven's sake. And after that, what really happened was my being in the high school choir, being the pianist for the choir. And although I had enjoyed studying and playing solo piano, nothing gave me a kick like playing for all these voices, both as a group and many, many times as soloists too. And I thought, wow, I don't want to sit around playing solo piano music. I want to be making music with other people.
That's wonderful.
There was no term collaborative pianist in those days. We just said accompanying. And, you know, I'm very fond of saying that both the word accompanying and the word collaborative are usually misspelled. So it really doesn't matter.
So would you talk about these answers, Martin?
Well, you know, a coach is a vehicle with horses in front, right? I thought that might be what somebody thought. Then there is a famous pocketbook company, very expensive purses for ladies, called Coach. And I thought that might be a possibility. Sometimes in an opera, a singer has to go in the wings, change clothes, and come back very quickly in a different costume. And I thought maybe there'd be a coach back there helping the person in and out of clothing. And then, you know, when you say, hey, coach, we always think of sports, right? And so I said, somebody on the sidelines who screams.
Exactly.
It's unhappy.
And as a vocal coach, there's so much to it. We'll talk about that a little bit later in this session. And I know a little bit about your world, and I admire what you do as a vocal coach and public pianist. We have our second poll question. Would you rather see an opera or an art song recital? I have a short clip, Martin, of a voice masterclass from a long, long time ago. Can you tell us about this video, this clip?
This is a very famous historic singer named Lotte Lehmann, an Austrian lady, who was in the time of Richard Strauss and Mahler and those guys, and she had the great fortune of premiering the world premieres of many of the Strauss opera roles. Anyway, when she was older and retired, she moved to Santa Barbara, California, and she taught both privately and for a school called the Music Academy of the West. She was a big influence on me when I was 18 years old, because I would travel up from LA to Santa Barbara, it's only an hour and a half, and I would play voice lessons for singers from LA who took lessons with her. To make a long story short, if you didn't tell a story with your singing and your playing, she'd just stop you. You had to know who you were, why you were saying this, even with the piano introduction, even when the piano had a postlude after the singer was done. At all times, the only function of the pianist and the singer was to tell stories and paint pictures. And no one had ever really said that to me before. People had said, oh, play a little faster or a little shorter or a little louder, you know, whatever, but not, why are you doing this? What's happening in the story? And that just completely opened my imagination.
Wonderful.
I use it to this day, and I insist with my own students that they do the same thing. So she was a major cornerstone influence for me.
But I saw her on this one Sunday standing in the door. Oh, if only I could be with her. The whole week I haven't seen my sweetheart, but on Sunday I saw her saw her walking to church. Oh, if only I could be together with her.
There, Madame Lehmann, as we called her, was narrating the English translation of a Brahms song called Sunday. And as she proceeded to teach the singer that followed that narration, she wasn't happy. She was not ever satisfied with how many colors and how many paintings the singer was making as she did the song. If we listen to the whole clip, you would see eventually the singer have to do more and more and more to bring the story to life.
That's great. You know, this reminds me of many of the lessons I've had with you. It's fabulous.
Oh, wow. Thank you.
So here are the answers. The audience chose art song recital. I'm impressed.
Me too. Go team.
Yes, that's wonderful. So I wanted to ask you to talk about the difference. What turns you on about them?
An opera is a completely staged, costumed story same as a play, only with music. And an art song is probably the least stimulus-laden event that can happen on a stage. It's one person singing a song, sometimes in your language, sometimes in a different language, and one pianist playing. No sets, no costumes, no change of lighting, no dancing around or, you know, getting on a hoppy horse and running around the room, anything like that. So it takes much more concentration from both the performers and from the audience, which is why the verdict of your poll really surprises me. And I'm very crazy. I'm very happy to see that percentage. That's wonderful.
Great. You have performed with so many great vocalists for over 50 years.
I'm probably the oldest guest you've ever had on here.
No, no. Actually, you started when you were five, I'm sure. Any really important memories of some of these amazing singers? I'm going to share a photo that I've seen on your piano at home with the audience. Oh my goodness, Marty's Girls.
Yeah. The first thing to say is that nickname doesn't get used by anybody anymore. Oh. It's given up for Lent in 1983 and it's never coming back. So it's Martin to everybody. The one on the top, of course, is Marilyn Hornham. I know we'll get around to talking about her later. Going clockwise, there is Dame Kiri Te Kanawa, who is still singing a little bit now. Your audience might have heard her at Prince Charles's royal wedding years ago. Then in the 5 o'clock position is Judith Blagan, a wonderful lyric coloratura soprano that I played for, oh my gosh, 20 years. And Zhang, her husband, was the youngest concertmaster ever for the Metropolitan Opera.
Wow.
Fit in with your instrument. Okay. Then at 7 o'clock is Frederica von Stade, who's still singing a little bit, not recitals, but once in a while she'll do a song or something. And finally in the 10 o'clock position is Tatiana Troyanos, mezzo-soprano, who has passed away, but she was very exciting to play for. And she played the piano so well that playing for her was scary, because I thought she would just sit down and show me how it should be done.
Anyway. And here I have a photo of you in Finland.
Yeah, with Karita Mattila, a wonderful dramatic soprano from Finland. She's about 6 feet tall and I'm 5'4". And when she hugs me on the stage, my face hits her right in the chest. It's very embarrassing.
And then of course, Miss Horn.
Yeah, this is my longest partner, a real cornerstone of my whole life, Marilyn Horn. 37 years I was with her.
Yes, that's wonderful.
Yeah.
So I have a short clip of you two performing, you and Marilyn Horn performing decades ago in Italy. Can you share with us the background knowledge of this short video clip, please?
Marilyn was always into American songs and particularly the songs of Stephen Foster. We did Jeannie with the light brown hair almost every concert we ever did as an encore. And this is another Stephen Foster song called Beautiful Dreamer. It's just amazing to me how a singer who can handle the most demanding technical up and down and around kind of singing can still sing something as simple as this melody with such expression and refinement. I hope your audience will find it the same way.
Beautiful dreamer, dream on my heart, in as the morn on the streamlet and sea.
Bravo. Bravo, Martin. Wow, she's such a fabulous singer. And I love the way you work together. You know, we often pay attention to the melodic, to the singers, to the soloists. And I want you to know the reason that I love music so much is because people like Martin, the collaborative pianist, the art of his collaborative piano playing that really make us soloists and singers to be where we are and then to work together as one team. This is inseparable and invaluable. And I really appreciate everything you've done, Martin, in our industry.
Very sweet, thank you.
So we're gonna move on. I have a quick question from the audience. Where have you performed, where have you not performed, and any favorite venues of yours?
Well, I've never performed in Antarctica because I don't think there's a piano there, okay. Although I've been to Antarctica. But oddly enough, I've never been to China, and I hope to do that before I leave this planet. But gosh, I've been to Australia, I've been to Europe a million times. I've been to Japan a million times. I've only done one concert in Africa, and that was in Egypt, so I'm not sure that even counts. It's so north there. But I like to include it when I say five continents or six continents. So.
Wow. What is your favorite venue or venues?
In our country, in the United States, I'm very partial to Symphony Hall in Boston and the Academy of Music in Philadelphia. These are old halls. Your audience should know that. This is before the science of acoustics really became a science. And they were built with wood and not with cement or anything like that. Carnegie Hall is right up there.
Would you share some unforgettable or funny moments during your concert career in the past 50 years?
Huh. How much time do you have? Marilyn Horne and I once did a concert in a church that had a marble floor where the piano was. And we very often began with Handel, which is full of florid music, lots of scales and jumps and all those things. And while we were doing this scary bravura aria, the piano started moving away from me. You know, the bench wasn't moving, but the piano was moving. So my arms are only so long, and I was having a hard time reaching the keyboard. So without ever stopping the music, Miss Horn started to push the piano back toward me. And she pushed it back farther than was appropriate. So suddenly I was playing like this, and then I began to push it back. That went on for, I don't know, 32 measures of a kind of a war between us. And meanwhile, we're doing scales as fast as they can go at the same time. That was kind of amusing. You wanted me to mention that time when the piano bench broke in a suburb of Chicago, and I landed on my whatever. And since that time, all the way to the end of Marilyn's career, when we got to that measure where the accident happened, we both had to, like, I don't know, bite our cheek and do everything possible not to start laughing. I mean, that, like, 35 years later, we were still gonna laugh if we weren't careful. And that happened in a very serious, fierce Handel aria. So laughter would have been very, very out of place.
Thank you for sharing. I have a very special guest, a close friend of mine who's a UD colleague, joining us to ask some questions on behalf of the audience. A fantastic vocalist and educator, Dr. Blake Smith, is an award-winning singer, teacher, actor, and stage director who serves as the director of vocal studies at UD and also the opera director at the University of Delaware. He has performed principal operatic roles throughout the United States and has performed as a soloist with orchestras in many of the nation's premier concert halls, including Carnegie Hall, Philadelphia's Verizon Hall, Dallas's Meyerson Symphony Hall, and among many others. And I like to formally welcome Blake to Master Players Backstage Pass Online. Thank you for joining us, Blake. Can you hear me?
I can, Sean. Thank you. And Martin, it's great to be here.
Nice to see you again.
Thank you so much for having me.
So you and Martin collaborated back in 2016 on Master Players stage when we produced our first concert opera, Magic Flute, by Mozart. And I'm so glad you're able to join us today to reconnect with Martin. I think you might have some questions for Martin.
Absolutely. So Martin, again, it's so great to see you. So you've enjoyed an illustrious career spanning 5 decades. Can you talk to us a little bit about how the business has changed during those 50 years of your professional career?
Wow, yeah, thank you. You know, there was video played no part in a singer's life back then. Everything was live or on a vinyl recording, something like that. CDs didn't exist, and especially anything visual didn't really exist. There were no broadcasts from the Met or anything when my career started. So singers didn't have to worry so much about how they looked, you know, or how much they weighed or how tall they were or short they were.
Sure. And,
you know, if you had a short tenor, pardon me, Blake, you're not a short tenor, but but if you had a short tenor and a tall soprano, nobody really knew because they sounded great together. And then with the advent of digital everything, suddenly the visual became as important in a soloist life as anything else, maybe sometimes too much, if I may say so. That's one way in which it's changed. And it's everything is so accessible now that long tours to bring music to places that didn't have a lot of concerts, they don't exist anymore because like we're doing right now. You know, you just dial in or get on YouTube or whatever, and the concert is in your living room, whether there is a virus in the world or not.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's played a very significant role in how the business has changed.
Probably in some good and some bad ways.
Exactly.
I mean, so speaking of that, having as someone who grew up without a lot of access to classical music in a very a rather rural area of East Texas, I came to know your work and the work of many other great singers through recordings, and still have just shelves full of CDs. Can you talk about how many recordings you've made, both with singers and instrumentalists?
Oh, I don't know the quantity. And there are people who recorded far, far more than I ever did. Like all the British collaborative pianists, they have a gazillion recordings. I just have a few. Recording is, I should love it because you can just redo it until it's right. At the same time, there's so much pressure. I create my own pressure that this is going to be for posterity, and it has to be, fabulous all the time. And then each time you're recording the same music again to get it better, some of the emotional bloom goes away and you need to concentrate on the non-artistic part of it, the technical perfection of it. I much prefer just doing a live concert and having somebody record it. When we listened to the Marilyn Horn thing a moment ago, of course, that was a live concert. You heard the audience's applause. That's great, because then I don't have to worry about being perfect. I always like to miss notes right away in the very first measure so that I've ruined the perfection and now I don't have to sweat it anymore.
Of course. Well,
and I always manage to miss those notes.
Well, and I would imagine also that if you could collect all the individual takes into one perfect take, it probably would be even better. But, you know, there's...
Yeah.
You know, one time it may feel perfect, and another time it may feel a little less inspired in the first half, but better in the second half. So,
And also, there's the whole notion of performing with someone else. So if you and I were making a recording together, you might have the very best take of the high B in Nessun Dorma.
Oh, yeah.
And I blow it exactly at that time. Now you have to do it again, or vice versa.
Sure.
So I think it's tough. I think recording is tough.
Well, we have a short audio clip of your recording with one of our world's most loved and warm and generous singers, Federica von Schade. And I, listening to this a moment ago, I was fascinated. This is an arrangement I'd never heard before. Can you share some memories or information about that?
Just as the Stephen Foster song we already heard was an arrangement not written down. I just had the bare bones in front of me. And this I never wrote down. I just kind of improvised it. It was always a little different from performance to performance. I've been very flattered when people write me to ask me if I could please send them a copy of an arrangement that I've done. And I can't because I don't have it, you know?
That's wonderful. I mean, again, how do you follow something like that? Wonderful. And again, thank you so much to both of you for such a wonderful, wonderful work. So Martin, you have been in the Academy for more than 30 years and at the University of Michigan as an endowed professor. Can you talk to us about why teaching?
Oh my gosh, I love it. Why do I love it? I don't know why I love it. I love to see people explore what they didn't think they could do, how much they could do. And I love to think that a little teeny piece of me is in the head of my students, a tiny piece of me is in the head of my students long after we don't see each other. I know that's pretty selfish of me, but if ever ask themselves a question that I ask them long after we've said goodbye, then I figure I'm still around.
That is absolutely true. I mean, this is, teaching is rather indulgent in that respect, in that we get to share and that we want to be a part of those people's stories. That's really wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah, teaching is not about telling the answers. It's about telling the questions. I read that a long time ago, and I think that's really true.
So, Martin, I also have some quick questions. You know, I'm honored to be one of your former students. I learned so many sonatas, and I watch you coach singers. I fell in love with the art. Where are all your piano students, their vocal coaches and collaborative pianists? Can you share with us?
Well, you know, it's terrifying, really terrifying. I don't know how it happened. It's kind of like rabbits having babies or something. In Japan, in Korea, all over Europe, here in the United States, at the Metropolitan Opera, and all the young artist programs that are pretty well known in Chicago, Los Angeles, Washington. I don't know. I was a student in South America, a former student in South America, in Canada.
Wow.
It's really amazing.
That's great.
Sometimes I just cannot believe how lucky I've been.
Well, they're very lucky to have you. You know, one of our colleagues here on our faculty, Dr. Oksana Glotchko, asked a quick question. She's a collaborative pianist herself. She said that you ask your students, your pianists, to actually sing the parts of instrumentalists or vocalists solo part, when they, while they're learning the score, preparing for rehearsals and concerts, why do you ask them to do that? What is the benefit? So our piano students can hear from you directly.
I don't actually ask them. I tell them they have to do it. I'm not that polite. I think if you can sing and play a piece simultaneously, in other words, doing both parts at the same time, and it doesn't have to be a vocal piece, it could also be a violin piece, then when you take away the part that you're not going to do, when you're going to just play the piano, how much easier is that when you made yourself do both things? That's one facet of it. The other most important thing is the breathing. Whether it's a piece for voice or not for voice, music needs to be human. It needs to breathe. It isn't math. And until you've experienced that breathing in your own body as a pianist, all your phrasing is just going to be artificial. And if you've done it as using your lungs, we all have lungs, right? Then your phrasing is, I think, going to be really human, really natural, really organic. And the singer or the violinist, frankly, is going to sense that he or she has a physical ally sitting at the piano, not just a partner, you know, who gets part of his paycheck or something, but someone who is experiencing exactly the same physical things inside.
That's great. You know, what I learned the most from you as a student was to sing wordlessly as an instrumentalist. There's always storytelling, there's always a scene, I'm always in the story, imagining myself in an opera or something. Can you share with us if you believe different instrumentalists without words, without text, can imagine different things in the same rehearsal, during the same concert, on the same stage? How does that work for you?
Of course it does. I don't even always know what my partner is imagining, especially when there are no words, okay? If you and I did the sonata by Franck, for example, and the second movement I think of as a thunderstorm, and you might think of it as a, you know, going jogging or something, I don't know. But as long as the music is served up in a way that we can synchronize both rhythmically and expressively, then it doesn't really matter whether we're thinking the exact same thing. The minute you get to songs when there is a text to it, then our imagination has to be limited by what the words are actually saying. Yeah. Both limited and enhanced by what the words are actually saying.
That's great. And you know, for us instrumentalists, our job is to imitate vocalists. I mean, the closer we are to a singer, the more successful we become as musicians. But the way you actually coach and teach instrumentalists is a very important part of training that many of us really value so much, to how to sing with our instruments. And Blake has some other questions, I see.
Yes. So Martin, we have a short audio clip of a masterclass with you and a pianist and a singer. From a place that means a lot to you, the Music Academy of the West in California. Mm-hmm. Can you share with us, what are your activities like there?
Your audience may not know, this is a summer music school in Santa Barbara, California, about 90 minutes north of Los Angeles. I went there as a student in the 60s, and now I'm there as a faculty member, which is kind of funny.
Wonderful.
What are my activities? I work exactly as I do at the University of Michigan. I coach singers, and I work with pianists who collaborate with those singers. This clip we're going to see, shall I say a word about
this? Please.
This is a very famous song by Schubert called Death and the Maiden, and it's also been made into a string quartet by Schubert. But here we're working on the song, and the song is in three parts. The death enters in the piano. The singer tries to prevent death from killing him in part two, and then part three, death wins.
Okay, let's talk about first, how does death get in this room? Christina? Since you have two-thirds of the song by yourself. and the introduction, we would never know there was a maiden, and we would never know there was a fast tempo coming. We would never know any of that. So that's death, I assume, sneaking into the room. And then James sings the part of death, and then you play the amen to that, okay? So how does death get in here, in your imagination? Does he open the door and survey the girl and wait till she sees him, or how?
Kind of floats in.
Floats in through a closed door.
Yes.
Or how about under a closed door? How about like cyanide gas under a door? Something like that, you know? So that she has, I'm gonna use the she has no idea of what's happening, right? Super. Do you feel you snuck in? She could play softer. I'm not saying it's easy, but when I play this, I try to play inaudibly. Can you do it? I did notice that she didn't have her left foot on the soft pedal. Number one, that's ridiculous, okay? Your left foot should be in China. It should be so much on the soft pedal, okay? Come on, scare us with the dynamic. Amaze us with the dynamic. Pretty good. How about half of that? Is that possible? How about half of that? No articulation, nothing. I prefer that, okay? If I have to choose, okay? Not an idea of a crescendo, nothing. And if you know Christina, you would be saying, what's wrong with Christina that she plays like that? It doesn't have shape, it doesn't have color, it's not here, it's creepy. Good, wonderful. Now, exactly when do you see her? See him, James? Great. So part of this is the visual of the thing, the theatricality of it, huh?
Yeah.
So are we putting death on the floor?
Maybe scooping in like gas, slowly rising.
Okay, all right. Okay. Now, you're crying out for your life, mm-hmm. right? That seems a very conservative speed to save your life. Mm-hmm. The piece is written in cut time, mm-hmm. so that includes the fast tempo. Mm-hmm. And if we listen to the piano part, can you play the Floriba part? So I don't know that I'm right, but for me, that's the woman doing as we played. It's not notes at all. It's
right.
Heavy breathing and pleas and all that stuff. Can we go a lot faster?
Sure.
Great. It's easy to play.
There's a reason the Michigan is lucky to have you, the way you teach to really inspire the next generation of singers and pianists. So I wanted to share with the audience that one other big person in our industry influenced your career. You've told me many, many times, Mr. Yasha Heifetz. Would you share with us this amazing idol of many of us, your story with him?
Well, I was very fortunate to play his classes and lessons at the University of Southern California when I was a junior and a senior there. So I was really quite young, and here you're playing for the most famous fiddler in the 20th century. I don't even know how I knocked on the door. When I went to audition for him, I was so nervous driving in the hills above Los Angeles to his house that I went into the wrong driveway and knocked down a small retaining wall on someone's house. And I just waved to the owner and said, I'll be back, but I have to play for Mr. Heifetz. So then I drove away. So I guess you could call that my only hit and run that I ever had in my life.
Wow.
I don't know even how to talk about it. Mr. Heifetz was not complimentary very often, but that meant that when he did give you a compliment, whether it was to the violinist or to me, it meant the world. I still, to this day, know exactly in my whole repertoire where he said something nice to me. Because he was so demanding on himself for his entire life that a person like that can't be less demanding on other people, even if he tried to be. He was also a prankster, I have to say. he would throw chamber music parties for us at his home. And he would say, I don't know what we're going to play. I don't know. Maybe we'll do Schumann, or maybe we'll do Brahms or something. We'll just work it out when you guys get there. So we would get there completely not knowing anything about what we were going to play. Meanwhile, he had practiced the first violin part to the Trout and the first violin part to the Schumann Quintet and all that stuff. So we were basically sight reading. giggling. It's kind of fun.
So Yasha Haif is regarded as the greatest violins of the 20th century and my absolute idol. I want to share this short video clip with everybody so you know who Haif is in case you don't know Haif. I remember that you told me one time that he asked you to almost sight read the Strauss violin sonata second movement that almost looked like totally black with all the 64th notes.
I wish I could hold up a score to this so that your audience could see. The slow movement, of course, is called a slow movement because it's slow. But in the middle of that slow movement, suddenly the composer adds 32nd notes and 64th notes so that the thing looks like an anthill that has been just kicked open. And there's no way that any pianist could make any sense of this. It looks like a digital series of marks on the page or something. And I had to sight read this for him. I got the job, but I don't know why I got the job.
Martin, do you know when did the term collaborative pianist started? Someone in the audience asked.
Yeah, I think it was pretty recently, actually. I'm going to say maybe in the last 20 years, maybe 25. I think people always thought the word accompanist or accompanying was kind of a second class professional name. It never bothered me because I always have gotten so much joy out of it. But it began to sound like you were putting the person down as being unimportant. And so people, it wasn't my idea, but I think some of the schools that teach collaborative piano began to change the name of the course from accompanying to collaborative piano. And yes, I mean, as I said earlier on this webinar, people misspell both words, so it doesn't really matter. But I think it matters more how you play and how you make music with others than what you call yourself, really. Marilyn Horn used to say, why did they say Marilyn Horn mezzo soprano and Martin Katz piano? Can't they figure out who's which?
I like that. So we have another poll question for the audience. Have you ever heard of the term collaborative pianist? And then the next question is, did you know the difference between the piano accompanist and the collaborative pianist? And Martin will talk about the answer a little bit later. So Martin, I want to share selfishly a short audio that you and I made in a CD of that very sonata, the second movement of the Strauss sonata, Richard Strauss sonata that you played for Mr. Haif. And of course, I'm nowhere near Mr. Haif, but I really enjoyed this collaboration so much. If you don't mind, I'll share just the first few seconds of it.
Of course. Actually, Zhang, that's why I first became so interested in you when you were at school, is because I thought you were playing in the same style with the same expression as the good old days when Haif was playing. That really...
Thank you. Everybody, I paid Martin to say that. So, thank you.
Thank you.
So Martin, some people in the audience asked me to ask you, do you teach vocalists and instrumentalists differently?
Well, of course, when you teach singers, right away, the text that they're, the words that they're singing has to get equal attention to the actual sound coming out of their mouth and how they're getting the words together. And that doesn't exist with instrumental music. But I think that's really the only difference. Since I don't play a string instrument or a wind instrument, I sometimes have to ask the student of those instruments, is this possible to do what I'm asking you to do? And they'll say, well, yeah, but it's tricky. And I'll say, well, then do it, you know, kind of thing. With singing, I don't feel I have to ask the singer, is it physically possible? Because everybody can sing. And I know that since I've sung it myself, that it's possible. Yep. That's the only differences I can think of. The instrumental works are usually longer. So if you have a lesson that's an hour long, you may not cover an entire piece in one lesson, whereas songs are the shortest musical beings that exist, and it's very possible to do many of them in one lesson.
Martin, Sean mentioned before that you've said that to be able to feel the love from an audience can be really magical. I mean, what advice might you have for young singers and young collaborative pianists about finding and feeling that love?
Well, you have to earn the love, don't you? You don't just walk out and play. And you have to earn it by giving it all you've got, whether it's as soft as you can play, as I said to the young lady in the masterclass, or whether it's loud, or whether it's expressive, or whether it's dazzling, if it's some virtuoso piece for violin or flute or something, or whether it's so profound in meaning that you almost can't talk about it. I mean, that's what I mean by earning. You go out there on the stage and you strive for perfection. Of course, you never get it. And you have to kind of forgive yourself for falling short. But that doesn't mean you don't strive for it.
Absolutely. I mean, can you talk to us a little bit about the answer to the poll questions from a moment ago?
The difference between a piano accompanist and a collaborative pianist, I think it's really only a matter of semantics. As I said earlier, there is a slight feeling of second-class citizen about accompanist in some people's minds, not in mine. But it's like if you were playing a string quartet, Zhang, and you were the second violinist, would you feel, not ashamed, but would you feel less important being called, hello, I'm the second violinist in the blah, blah, blah quartet, as opposed to I'm the first violinist. I think once in a while, you meet people who think accompanist has that pejorative kind of ring to it. As I say, it doesn't to me, but as long as it exists for some people, then let's use the word collaborative pianist and everybody will be happy.
Well, and absolutely. After all,
that's what we do is collaborate. We're not always the followers. Sometimes we're the leaders.
Absolutely. Well, and as an author, you wrote, you know, your first book, The Complete Collaborator, has been published by Oxford University Press and is widely considered the seminal work on the subject. I often introduce you as the person who literally wrote the book on collaborative pianists.
Not true.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
Oh, gosh. My first book, I haven't written my second book yet, so my book, okay? I really have to thank my students of all these 34 years at Michigan. That's how that book got written, because you, in order to articulate your beliefs, you have to have been telling them to people. I'm sure you experienced that as a voice teacher yourself. You know, this sentence means more to the student than that sentence. And finally, after trying many different ways to get it across, you, oh, wow, bingo, that one works. You write it down and then it becomes a line in a book. I just wanted to get this all down, you know, before I couldn't write anymore.
Sure. Well, and the world is better for it, so thank you for that.
Oh, thank you.
Great. And but can you talk to us about your experience as a conductor, a role that you've been taking over later in your career, and as an editor?
Well, the conducting thing is a very standard path for a collaborative pianist who's been working with singers. There are so many great conductors. I don't include myself, but if you think of Georg Scholte and Bruno Walter and Herbert von Karajan and James Levine and I don't know, on and on, Bruno Walter, did I mention him already? They all played rehearsals in opera houses and they all coached singers. And then it was just kind of normal for them to know the music so well that it was part of their, literally of their bloodstream, this music. And then to jump onto the podium and help other people create the same things in the orchestra that they had been doing on the piano for years and years. The editor thing is the smallest part of my career, to be honest. It's because of Miss Horn and Miss von Stada both sang a great deal of early music. By that I mean Rossini and Handel. And those things do not publish themselves. You know, there are all these different versions of them.
Sure.
Be brought together, the music is so old compared to something written in the 19th century. So occasionally they would ask me, would you create a version of this opera for me? And I didn't do it very often and it was backbreaking work, but it was done by the Metropolitan Opera and done by the National Opera of Canada. That's not exactly the right name, but you know what I mean?
Sure.
Those are, I guess, side things of my career.
Great. Thank you, Blake. So Martin, I have to tell the audience we have to finish very soon. You know, this session brought back so many great memories. I used to tell my friends after lessons, I'm like, I just experienced the most amazing concert in a lesson, and just so many goosebumps moments studying with you. You're an amazing artist and wonderful educator and just very inspiring. But have you received any great advice yourself? What's the best advice you've ever received?
I think that no decision is perfect. And when you make a decision, you have to be prepared to give up something for that decision. And it may not be ideal, but you still have to decide. That applies to music. It applies to crossing the street. It applies to choosing a partner, you know.
That's great. Thank you. I want to thank Blake again for joining us and asking questions on our behalf. And Martin, thank you so much for making time for us. I wish you both and all your families, family members, a healthy and safe summer. We're so looking forward to Martin's return for your Brahms concert. We plan to have all three violin piano sonatas by Brahms performed by you and me and some of our colleagues here soon after the COVID-19 crisis. And we have one last video of another amazing masterclass you gave on the stage of Carnegie Hall, Well Recital Hall. We'll share this with the audience as our season finale. Before that, I want to thank all our audience members so much for coming today. I hope you all enjoy the season's presentations. We have announced our summer events and also the 2021 season concerts on our website and also in emails. We hope to see you in concert or online for those live streamed events. And please be safe and see you during the summer concerts in late July. And now back to Martin.
Well, I just have to thank Xiang Gao, the man who's been talking to you along with me, for inviting me both to the concert series and now to this in its place and hopefully next season. I also want to thank his team, Jasmine and Binray, for the technical side of things, for teaching this unsavvy person how to negotiate this webinar. And I just, let's all stay safe and sane, which is maybe harder than staying safe. And I'll see you soon in person.